Well, your partner and tell him to look at it. We will not get into it. It's very slightly more complicated than what can be covered in the next 5 minutes. So I will not get into it. But other than CVR, if an account has been restructured, from the date of the application for restructuring, if the entire sanction has been given and has been implemented within a period of 90 days, then the account need not be downgraded. It can continue to be performing. Again, provided some other costs are met. For example, as you said, the account should be fully secured. The promoter sacrifice of the bank should have been brought in. Some other conditions which are there, as long as they are fulfilled, it can be continued to be, it can be upgraded, although it could have slipped to non-performing during the 90 days period. You also mentioned that restructuring is not applicable to exposure to capital markets. Perfect. Absolutely right. Any loan given for exposure to capital market, which is loan against shares or stocks, cannot be restructured. It's not the only loan which cannot be restructured. There are two other categories of loans which cannot be restructured. Essentially, commercial real estate cannot be restructured. Personal loans cannot be restructured. If somebody has been given a personal loan, that cannot be restructured. All other loans are eligible for restructure. An account can be performing or it can be non-performing. It doesn't matter, it can be restructured. The only account which cannot be restructured, where the borrower has been a fraud. You know, he's indulged in fraudulent activities, it cannot be restructured. But otherwise, all these things can be restructured. There is also one other classification. Anand spoke about classification in terms of performing, non-performing. And in the non-performing, he spoke about substandard, doubtful, and loss. There are also other classifications that needs to be done in the bank audit, for which they themselves do the classification and give it to you, but you need to check whether the classification is right or wrong. For example, facility-wise accounts are classified. Facility-wise means bills purchased and discounted, cash credit, overdrafts and loans repayable at demand, and term loans. These are the three classifications into which all the loans of the bank is classified under these three categories, which is called a facility-wise classification. You have something called a security-wise classification. Again, these are all the same accounts which is going into different forms. And you will finally, what you need to ensure is any of these classifications, the total of that classification must jive with the total of the advance from the GL. Because you can't have a total advance of 100 crores and facility wise it is only 99 crores or 101 crores. Whether you classify it into facility wise or under security wise, it has to be the same. So you need to ensure that is done. Classification wise, which is what he spoke about, standard, doubtful, loss. But also sector wise. They have several classifications because the readers of the bank's balance sheet need to understand there are several users of the bank balance sheet. Sector wise, the advances in India, priority sector, public sector, bank, and others. So these are the five units which will go into the classification sector wise. And then you have advances outside India, again classified into due from banks, due from others, bills purchased and discounted, other syndicated loans. Any kind of classification is nothing but the same figure being put in a different format. So it has to tally. Ensure that it tallies. Those are the areas where you could actually have mistakes coming in. And in your anxiety for having failed to work, you might not actually cross-check. Please cross-check. Sector-wise, does it jive with the total? Security-wise, does it jive with the total of the advances? The other couple of other things that we need to do is whether claims have been lodged properly. If there is a claim, an insurance claim, has it been lodged properly? If there is an ECGC claim, has it been launched properly? These are things also which, as an auditor, you need to look in, because there are specific questions on this in the long form audit report in question number 5 with regard to advances, and you need to look at that. Also, please list out all the discrepancies you noted. Wherever it's possible, make a tabular column of your listing. For example, if you say, you can't make a vague statement saying in some of the cases, stock statements have not been submitted. You've got to clearly tell which account, what are the last date on which they submitted the stock statement. Because the stock statement was submitted in June last year, the account will become non-performing. Even though everything else might be right in that in the account. Because the stock statement is more than 3 months old, it will become a non-performing. Again, I'm not getting into the intricacies of non-performing asset because there was a session for it in the afternoon during which my good friend Sundar Rajan will talk to you about that. But please understand that there is a significance to each one of those questions given in the long form audit report. So you need to prepare tabular columns. Don't vaguely say, in some cases, stocks was not insured. If you tell me that you have seen 10 cases, and out of the 10 cases, 8 cases insurance not available, I want the list of the 8 cases, those 8 account numbers, the name of the borrower, what are the insurance already available and how much is it underinsured, or if there's no insurance available, no insurance available. Please give details like that. Anand has guided you through the question number 5, which deals with advances. There are lots of other questions, which is, I think, what is going to be done in the second session. I'm not sure who the student speaker is, but my good friend Uttam is here, who will actually guide you all with his expert comments on the rest of the long form audit report. Thank you very much for a patient hearing. Thank you.
I first of all thank Sri Ramesh for accepting our invitation and coming in spite of his busy schedule, and I humbly thank you, sir, for taking us this session in a very much simpler way, which all of us can understand. And you know, he's not only the expert in auditing bank, but he's also expert in helping the blood bank by donating 35 times in the few years. And so as a token of gratitude, I request the vice chairman of SICASA, Mr. Mohit, to give the memento to our chairman. Thanks a lot, sir. And next, the student speaker, P.V. Anand. And we really thank you, P.V. Anand, for coming and making so much efforts to make this presentation. And we know in spite of your office work, you have done this. And we thank you for coming here and presenting such a beautiful presentation. And on behalf of SICASA, we wish you all the best for doing the upcoming presentation well. And as a token of gratitude, I request Sonia to give the memento to P.V. Anand. I request you all to give a huge round of applause. And friends, we'll disperse for the tea break now and make sure that we'll be back within 10 minutes. Thank you.
Wish you all the very best.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. I take immense pleasure and pride in introducing the chairman for this session. The session name is LFAR, other than advances. Today's chairman is an eminent personality, C.A.P. Uttam Chand. He is qualified B.Com from A.M. Jain College. He is an FCA practicing since 1996. Position held: President of Associations of Chartered Accountants in Chennai. Past co-opted member, Library Committee of SIRC of Chennai. Past co-opted member, Students Committee of SIRC of ICAI. Past Management Committee member of Chartered Accountants Study Circle from Chennai. And even he has actively participated in revision publications of ICAI, such as Statements of Peer Review, Practitioner's Guide to Audit of Small Entities, and etc. Apart from this, he has presented many papers such as CPE chapters, many papers in for CPE chapters of SIRC of ICAI, at the Associations of Chartered Accountants in Chennai, at Society of Auditors, and he was also a trainer in Tally, took very many special sessions for Chartered Accountants. Then he has even been a trainer to National Academy of Customs, Excise and Narcotics in Chennai. Then he even regularly write up recent case laws for High Court and Supreme Court judgments in CASC journals. I think SIRC is very glad to have him as ITT department faculty for Tally accounting package. Apart from all this, he is also authored book jointly with CAP Anand, A Guide to Tax Audit, and that is also a CASC publications. I request chairman to come on the dais. Invite him. I request Krishnan to present a bouquet to our chairman. Thank you, sir. Now, students for the today's session is S. Ruben Kumar. He has completed his IPCC in November 2010. He is doing his articles in well-known firm Manoharan Chaudhary and Associates. He's even a graduate member of ICWAI. He has completed his BCom from Hindu College. I invite him to present his paper. Thank you.
A very good morning to everyone present here. And myself, Ruben Kumar. And I'm at the second year of my articles at Manohar Chaudhary and Associates. And before start, I would like to thank SICASA committee for organizing these types of programs, because these are truly knowledge transferring. To put it technically, it's a knowledge transfer from the speaker and the listeners and vice versa as well, and which is regulated by a chairman, Mr. Uttam Chand sir. And I am honored to be a speaker here because he is an eminent faculty, we all know, and even I did his ITT training under him and still remember the VAT provision in Tally. Thank you, sir. And the topic of the day is, as you all know, long form audit report. And the previous speaker, Mr. P.V. Anand, is my friend who covered on advances. So the basic introduction about this audit is, we want to know what is the business of the banking, first of all. As a nautical trainee, we would like to know about the entire operations of the bank we need to know the entire operations of bank before venturing in for an audit. So put it very simply, the assets of the balance sheet of the bank has assets and liabilities. In the asset side, advances comprises of more than 70%, which rightly pointed out by the previous speaker, Mr. Ramesh sir. He said that advances constitutes 70%. So there our objective starts. As a nautical trainee, we would like to know about what are advances, what are the different types of advances, where provisioning is required, where provisioning is not required, actually what are provisions, what are RBI guidelines, what does actually central statutory auditor norms, these and all we have to verify first of all before venturing into audit. And before that, I would like to give an overview of what audit is. Say, it starts with audit plan, it's continues with audit program, then selection of article students represented by team audit manager partners, and the target is nothing but our client. Here bank audit, so bank is the target for us, and we need to know what type of audit it is. As he rightly said, there are different types of audit in a bank: concurrent audit, statutory audit, and other forms of audit. I would like to say that we may be an issuing authority, a certificate sort of thing. For that, we have to do a due diligence kind of review or something. So first of all, we should be very clear in what we are doing. Say, this session is only for statutory audit. Concurrent audit doesn't come under LFAR. So this LFAR, I would like to stress this letter L, because it is long form. It is not short form. What is short form means main audit report. The standard audit report which the auditor gives after auditing all the banking transactions and after completing all his scope, he will issue an audit report which is in short form. This is considered short form because in the earlier 92 and 93, many questions have been raised on the auditors stating that it is not complete. Audit is not complete or in entirety. And therefore, the RBI gave a guideline stating that you need to put up one more audit. The output is long form audit report. Nothing but it's a questionnaire. Questionnaire can be otherwise said as a checklist. Nothing but it has a plenty of things, close to 50, 60 items, in which every article student or every audit manager or every principal for that matter has to closely vouch what has been asked and what is the need for that particular item. And the very first thing, advances. As Anand covered in exhaustive way, I'm not going to touch upon. I'm just going to extend my presentation with the next thing on other than advances. My structure of presentation is basically a balance sheet and P&L analysis. Balance sheet has two sides. To put it very simply, assets and liabilities. And P&L has two sides, revenue expenses and revenue income. The output of balance sheet is nothing but the current affairs of the banking I mean, current affairs of the bank has been projected at that point of time, stating that if a shareholder wants to invest in that bank, he wants to know what are the assets they have, whether my share will be secured, whether my share price will increase after I'm been trading. So this is the main purpose of giving a report in addition to the annual accounts. Annual accounts comprises of P&L, balance sheet, cash flow statements, along with signed by both management and the principal in charge for that audit. I mean, these are the outputs. So what are the inputs? Inputs comes in the form of audit procedure. Audit procedure is nothing but the process in which an articled assistant like, I mean, us going to undertake what are the things to be done to perform an audit efficiently and diligently. Diligently, I means you need to prepare ahead. As Sivakumar sir said, you need to read before venturing into audit. I mean, if at all, without reading, taking a questionnaire there and filling it up, you might be at the chances of, I mean, ignoring a thing or something will strike later. So therefore, to avoid all these risks, because as an article student, our works are accumulated in the form of this audit report. So therefore, we are under onerous task, because major portion of the task being conducted by the articled assistants, and only our works are accumulated and put into this report. So therefore, we have to ensure that whatever we do it in the right thing, right time and the right thing. So as I said before, audit plan, we need to plan ourselves. Okay, what are the requirements for this branch audit, that is bank branch audit? The first one is, you need to verify RBI circulars. I mean, you just Google it out, what are the recent RBI circulars which is applicable to that bank for which I am doing audit. Number two, what is the norms prescribed by central statutory auditors? Who are central statutory auditors? I mean, there are like this. There is only one head office. Head office, I mean head office of the bank. And there are 100 branches of that bank. 100 branches are spread across over India and even outside India. And we are going to be an auditor for one of the branch. So thereby, head office is the controlling authority which gives norms or prescribes guidelines in which certain things should be followed only in certain manner. It is nothing but these are the strict laws and regulations framed by the, I mean, controlling authority, which I often call head office. So therefore, after RBI, we should know what is this norms and procedures laid down by the controlling authority for the each branches in which we are going to do audit. And third one, audit means standards on auditing, earlier called auditing and assurance standard. So as an article student, since we are practically applying what we are reading, we need to understand. It's not just reading, we need to understand, and the application part of it works out in the form of practice. Practice, I mean here, doing auditing. So we need to ensure what are the standards on auditing which is applicable for this type of audit. Say, put a tick mark. These are the standards definitely going to be applicable, and these are the standards not going to applicable. Just ignore what is not going to applicable and concentrate only on what is going to be applicable. I mean, prepare your mind, stating that if at any point of time you may come across anything, you should able to link with what are the standards, what the standards say. I mean, what does ICAI say, what NACAS say. So these are the thing for preparatory level. After auditing standards, I would like to tell accounting standards. I mean, these are basically accounting. How P&L is drafted, how balance sheet is drafted, what are the cash flow statements, how provisioning is made, where has been taken, I mean, out of P&L, what portion has been taken out for reserves, what portion has been given as dividend, what portion has been recouped, buyback, different kinds of accounting. Students, so please, after auditing standards, be very well thorough with accounting standards, where to give a debit, where to give a credit, where this will affect in the general ledger, you need to know very clearly. This is the third level of preparatory level. And the next level of preparatory level is information systems, which is nothing but being skillful at, in front of desktop or PC. It is not going to be an era of Excel alone, because we all know as a student we'll be working, skillfully at Excel. When you're going into a bank audit, they hardly use Excel. they use a different software, EDP, or they design a software to suit particularly the transactions which is going to take place between the head office and the branch level and the networking transactions. If they give one debit here, it will reflect in all our things and it will automatically update. I mean, real-time updation will be there. So we need to be really taking enormous time of us to sit with a laptop or sit with a computer to know what is this software is all about, to sit with a branch manager, to virtually ask what is this first of all, because as they'll also be very very much knowing that these students might not be knowing about this new software that they of late built up. So it's never wrong in admitting that I'm new to this software. So just take some time, sit with a laptop, get worked used to it as to what is being happening and how the reporting is being culled out from the different types of statements, because out of these only you will be doing a sample test or so far called audit. So this is one of the preparatory level I would like to stress before making ourselves mind clear as to what we are doing. Next slide, please. Okay. As I earlier mentioned, long form is nothing but a questionnaire of different questions, close to 50-60 questions, of which close to 30 questions is handled by Anand. So remaining close to 40 questions I'll be taking off. In fact, I'll be running out through book. I brought a book here. I'll be running out just because it's a simple checklist, but it needs a careful attention on how well you're going to perform. Okay, coming to the banking thing, banks handles thousands of crores of money in India. So this is a very big industry handling close to 90% of the financial funds all over India. Therefore, a bank is a big target. A wrong debit or a wrong credit will cause a greater risk in terms of reliance placed by the individual customers, reliance placed by the corporate customers, reliance placed by the trust and other big corporate clients. So therefore, we need to, as an auditor, we need an additional we have an additional responsibility. Even if it is wrong, just report the wrong, report stating that these are the things gone against the manner in which it has been done. Because we cannot able to stop what has been happened. Since we are doing a postmortem, we can check only the adequate internal control as to what has been there. And because of this internal control lapse, the bank has had a mistakes in giving a wrong debit or wrong credit or wrong transaction, DD transfers, FEMA guidelines mismatch, whatever may be the case. So as an auditor, coming in the month of April 1 to April 10, it's a very short period of time for us to manage what are the different things we're going to do and file it up in the form of long form audit report, which I always say end product of an auditor. So there are two forms. One is short form, nothing but main audit report given by an auditor. And second one is in addition to that, but it cannot be called as an annexure. Even this is a standalone audit report called as long form audit report. And reporting requirements, reporting in the sense as an auditor, after finishing your audit, what are the things you're going to report? This carries an enormous value in the terms of shareholders meeting in the form of annual annual general meeting, external general meeting, whatever you call it, because banking also comes under companies only. It's banking companies, right? And I forgot to mention, we should also know about Banking Regulation Act. Banking Regulation Act Section 30 says every branch of a bank needs to get its books of accounts audited by a qualified chartered accountant. So if we see, Companies Act doesn't prescribe that this bank has to be done an audit. So we need to come away, we should extend our scope from Companies Act, Accounting Standards on Auditing to the external level called Banking Regulation Act. There is also another act called Banking Regulation, State Bank of India Act. So we need to ensure what are the acts first of all being applicable, what are the rules that are relevant for our audit. Don't read in entirety, do a picking task as to what has been applicable. Have a great group discussion before going to an audit. Sit with your audit manager, ask n number of doubts, torture him like anything, and make your output really amazing, because this is going to help us, a future chartered accountant, to lead the role. Reporting requirement. As I said, long form audit report is the main crux of what I'm going to concentrate. Short form audit report is main audit report. tax audit report, we all know 44AB, and the certificates. I mean, banks has to complete these many procedures to get involved, to get complete its audit. And out of this long-form audit report, the LO alone has been odd man game since because it handled the, Mr. P.V. Anand. And I'll be taking care of other than advances, general and revenue items. The first thing after advances is cash. Nothing but the physical cash the bank has at any point of time in a month or whatever the cutoff procedure may be in a week or in a day or in a hour is being decided by the controlling authority. As I initially pointed out, controlling authority is a head office. Head office gives instructions and norms as to how much amount you should carry out. I mean, you should have a physical cash to meet up the requirements of day-to-day banking operations. So as an auditor, if suppose the guidelines is like this, you should have 2 crores every day physical cash in the bank. And as an auditor, if we come and vouch, if we find 3 crores, we need to report that excess cash has been handled. And if it is well below the limit, that is 2 crores, 1.6 crores or 50 lakhs, whatever may be the case, no need to report. So our crux of the game is whenever a norm is being exceeded or norm is being overdone, auditor has a duty to report the same. Because these are the instructions, then if it is not followed, it doesn't make sense. So when instructions are not followed or overdone, it as an auditor, we have to report the same. Second thing, verification of daily cash register. This is one of the audit procedure which as an article student we have to do. We have to ask for the cash register, compare with the physical bank, physical cash available, get in touch with the general ledger, whether it is matching, and check the internal control. How many securities are there? How many keys are there? The lockers, where they place their money, where they place the money in the chest or money chest, whatever. How being securitized? Look at the web camera, the CC camera that has been fixed in the different points of time. If at all some happens, we need to get an insurance cover. So check for insurance cover as well. Adequate insurance cover. Third one is periodic check on cash balances at branch. This is self-explanatory. And finally, reporting. As I already said, if the norms has been overdone, you should need to report. And report, don't just say vaguely, as Ramesha rightly pointed out, these many things have been overdone. Just put an annexure stating that out of these months, these number of days, this much amount has been exceeded. And out of the sample check which you done. So this will give a superb truly picture as to how effectively an auditor does his audit. Next one is balance with RBI. As a branch, it will have an account with RBI. It will have an account with other branches. It will have an account with other banks as well. So we need to get the confirmation as to the outstanding balances as on 31st March of so-and-so year. This is the main thing which we will do in audit. First of all, we will get a BRS, we will get books of accounts, we will vouch for whether every debit and every credit has been authorized, stamp duty has been paid if it crosses a certain amount of money, whether TDS has been deducted. So whatever be the check you have to do, finally, it will end up in the balance confirmation. If the balance confirmation from the external party, the other bank, is not matching with this, we need to check the BRS. And if the BRS perfectly matches, no need to report, and state that balance confirmation has been applied and it has been found incorrect with the balances with the other party. Third one is observation and the reconciled statements, which I just said. And finally, reporting. If you find any mismatches or any unadjusted long-term outstandings, you need to report the same, quantify the same, put the dates and stating that these much amounts has been not been matched and not been still credited. So BRS is not done fully. Money at call and short notice. Actually, when I asked about this to Mr. Sundarajan, sir said, it will not be applicable to much of the branch. And head office will lay the complaints as to what are the things you should need to maintain. And whether money at call, nothing but it's a short notice, say a 7-day period or 5 days period, you need urgent money. So a customer comes and asks for money at call or whatever. So these things as per the guidelines framed by the head office, it needs to move accordingly. And currently, only head office level handles these types of money at call. So we need no need to get involved much about it. Investments. Again, the same thing. Investments are generally handled at head office level, not much at branch level. Suppose when the branch has investments, I mean, it holds investments on behalf of the head office, then it should follow again the guidelines as framed by the head office. And it should know when to recognize the revenue on the investment, nothing but income on investment or dividend on investment. At what point of time it should show in the P&L that so much sum is going to be credited. I mean, it can be in accrual method or it can be in the cash basis, depending on the performing assets. Performing assets, nothing but investments. Even when I invest and when I expect so much of money, but it is very sure that I'm going to receive, say, for an FD interest, you can directly credit it to a P&L account, though it is not received on accrual basis. But if at all there is a question arise on whether actual investments are good or not, then you have to provide for a provision, or you have to credit in your account only when it has actually been recovered. On the recovery basis, you should credit it. Holding investments, okay. Physical verification certificate. Okay. The next thing is, whenever a branch has an investment which holds investment on behalf of the head office, then you should get a physical verification confirmation, which is nothing but they will come physically vouch what are the FDRs they have, physically vouch what are the share certificate they have, and they will give a certificate stating that on so and so date, so much of investments has been held on behalf of this branch to the head of, on behalf of the head office in this branch, and I find no any mismatches, and it is as per AS9 revenue recognition has been followed, and there is no any mismatches. We have to report the same. If at all anything arises, we need to clearly mention what is the mistake or what is the misappropriation that has been happened in investment. Other assets. So balance sheet analysis after advances, cash, and balances with RBI and other banks. Investments, and finally the small so far called other assets. I'd like to state an example here. What are other assets? They will generally say sundry assets. And for example, if the head office sends some of the checkbooks, DD drafts, and other related stationaries to the regional office, I mean to the branch office, they will account as only asset. Actually, it is an expense. Say printing expenditure needs to be debited. But what head office will do, it will treat as an asset till when the actual utilization of those stationery is being taken in the head office, being branch office level. How will they reverse it? I mean, after treating it as an asset in the head office account, when the actual leaflets are issued to the customer, when the actual DD receipts are taken, when the actual other FD receipts, whatever may be the thing, which customers comes in and fills up, put it in a drop-down box, which this on a going, on a taking basis, these assets will be reversed into printing expenses in the head office level. And test check the security items. Security, nothing but what are the stamps that have been available in the banks and other leaflets. Just go and test check and check whether the internal control is proper. And if at all any loss has happened, say a few leaflets are being lost, you should once again check the internal control and state that these are the internal control lapse. Because of this, you incurred a loss of so and so rupees and it needs to be rectified. You have to sit with the branch manager and speak with this internal control lapse. And same thing, you have to report the same. Suspense accounts. Suspense accounts, when an account is not identified fully or at the point of time it is not known, it is put under the category of suspense accounts. Generally, suspense accounts will be debit items, like sundry items only. For that, you obtain the breakup of outstanding items and compare with the general ledger. Both should match. I mean, general ledger acts as a control ledger for different types of subsidiary ledgers. And test check for any unusual items, any wide variations of debit or wide variations of credit. You need to know, you need to analyze whether any possible window dressing may be happened. So you need to question a lot, when you come across these types of wide variations in the suspense account. Because suspense account, generally, truly speaking, it should not be had. every account should be transparent. That is the main accounting principle. But having a suspense account, you need to check in full, I mean, check in total. Finally, reporting if at all any deviations widely happen. Deposits. I'll read out actually. Having the controlling authorities of the bank laid down any guidelines with respect to conduct and operations of an inoperative accounts. Say for example, there are 1,000 customers for a branch, and out of 1,000 customers, they'll be having different types of deposits, fixed deposits, recurring deposits, savings account, and different types of other accounts. And how it is, when it is called an inoperative account is when an account holder does not make any transaction with this banking personnel for a period of 3 years, then it will be inoperative. When an account is treated as an inoperative, branch manager has to freeze in the accounts, stating that even the same person comes and transacts business, he cannot do, because he has to prove his identity once again, stating that he is so-and-so person holding so-and-so PAN number and having an account, opened account some 3 years back. Because this has access and one more internal control, because even employees of the banks can misuse the accounts which has been inoperative. So this is one of the point highlighted by Sundarajan sir for me to deliver here actually. And you should, as an article student, you have to inquire with bank officials and check whether the inoperative accounts have been segregated periodically and blocked for not allowing transactions. Ask for exceptional reports from bank for inoperative accounts and test check in few accounts whether any transactions were entered during the year of audit. Say during the year of audit, though being inoperative, if find any transaction being taken out, you need to have additional precautionary measure whether it is that person who operated this account and whether branch manager has confirmed to reopen his account and to proceed with the transactions. And as an articled assistant, to verify the system of inoperative account as per guidelines issued by the controlling authority. If any deviation, it needs to be reported in the long form audit report. And many of the frauds in the branches are done in inoperative accounts wherein unauthorized operations are carried out. Hence, it has to be ensured that any transaction is allowed in the inoperative account only with due authorization of the designated officers or managers. And test check the verification of specimen signature in some cases may be done during the course of audit. And next one in deposits. After the balance sheet date until the date of audit, whether there have been any unusual large movements, whether increase or whether large decrease has happened in the aggregate deposits held at the end of the year. Because this may be due to window dressing. So we need to be aware of what may be the things can happen during at the end of the year, that is 31st March of so and so year, and till the date in which we complete the audit. And finally, are there any overdue or mature term deposits at the end of the year? So since it is a deposit, bankers would be under an obligation to repay the term deposits. Term deposits, I mean fixed deposits. If at all any overdue nothing but bank has not honored the fixed deposits in time. If at all happen, as an auditor, we need to report the same. Obtain the exception report from the branch officials for mature term deposits at the end of the year and report the same. Normally, deposits matured and overdue for more than 3 years are being transferred to head office, depending upon the internal guidelines as specified by the controlling authority. Few banks have a practice of automatic renewal. Say, for example, 5 years FD is closed, it will have an automatic renewal stating that once again FD is continued from what has been the final amount being credited to the account holder. So it has an automatic renewal. At that point of time, no need to state in the report saying that it has not been honored by the bank, because it will be with in agreement with the customers only. Finally, next, other liabilities. Bills payable and sundry debtors. The number of items and the aggregate amount of old outstanding items pending for 3 years or more may be obtained from the branch and reported under appropriate heads. Does the scrutiny of the accounts under various subheads revealed old balances? Old balances, nothing but that has been more than 3 years. If at all, give the details in a detailed format. This is what is being said in other liabilities. And also obtain a list of sundry deposits. Again, deposits is a liability for the bank and not an asset. Obtain a list of sundry deposits at the end of the year and confirm the same tallies with a ledger extract. This is one of the audit process. Next, report the number of items and the amount as per the format given in the LFAR. LFAR has a detailed format, no need for us to venture any new designs and all. So we need to just key in the numbers as to our observations from the audit. Obtain the sundry deposit register and scrutinize the same for unusual entries. And also for periodical reversal. Whether it has been periodically reversed or not, we should have a great check upon. And draft issued by the branch is disclosed under this head, but normally the branches do not maintain a breakup of the same. Hence, it is suggested to report with same accordingly with a possible note of disclaimer. Even you can able to suggest what are the best things that can be done for these type of things, in which they doesn't have a normal norms or guidelines from controlling authority. You can, as an auditor, suggest the same, in which a possible internal lapse could have been stopped. I mean, may be stopped. And finally, the next bucket, profit and loss account, which is nothing, it has two sides, revenue expenses and revenue income, and how we are going to audit and what are the different heads in which we are going to audit, we will see now. Profit and loss account. This reflects the operations which has been done and the result of the operations for the branch, I mean, particular branch of a bank. So whether the branch has a system to compute discrepancies in the interest. When looking at the P&L account, the main credit chunk will relate to the interest. As I said before, advances are the major business for any banker. It has an income in the form of interest. This interest finds place in the credit side of the P&L account. So therefore, when we check upon advances, we are under an additional obligation to match with the revenue which has been generated. And here, once again, we have to check in the middle, stating that if at all any asset has been proved bad, I mean non-performing asset, if the asset is performing, you will get interest at the correct time from the right person. If at all, even a single day delay, they might treat as non-performing asset, which the next speaker will be handling as to how many days you should treat this as a substandard, standard loss assets and different kinds of classifications. So we need to ensure that whenever the advances is given, whether the expected interest has been earned and not received. If it is a good debt, even earning, we can credit to the income comprising of accrual basis principle. And if at all an advances is gonna be a bad or non-performing, an adequate provision, a debit has to be made in the P&L account stating that to this much amount, we expect that our interest will not be credited or recovered by that customer. This is prudential. Actually, this is a prudential technique, as based on prudence. The auditing standards clearly say for all income, you just make a provision like anything, saying that you need to be cautious that you won't receive it fully. For all expenses, do not make any provision because you're gonna bear it for sure. 100% you need to make. So this is a concept of prudence. Actually, it falls under prudential norms. And again, going to the P&L account, if at all any discrepancies in the interest has been apprehended in the software of the banks, whether even in inbuilt software can check again what are the discrepancies that has been happened. I mean, it is one more of an information system control over on which the discrepancies may have in the earlier version of the computer software. So whether these has been properly designed to put a check on any discrepancies in interest. Say, for example, if any interest has been short or over-credited, this might balloon actually the P&L account, balloon actually the balance sheet. It won't reflect the true view of what is going to be stated as on 31st March. So auditors need to ensure whether whatever being items that has been credited or debited is the correct amount. And for that, we have to ensure what are the basic auditing principles, tools in which we have to go, we're going to watch and report the same. And finally, to test check interest provided by the branch for sample cases and discrepancies, if any, shall be reported. Verify the updation of systems for keying up of interest rates and ensure the correctness. Even the rate of interest, if at all, as sir said, corporate debt restructuring. If it is restructured, it is no longer at 10% interest or 15% interest. It is going to be changed. So as an article student, we need to ensure that these are the loans that are restructured. So it is normally doesn't fall under the earlier accepted agreement. So we need to have in check with the what is the latest restructured that has been happened. The banks have a system of test checking methodology which may be obtained and verified for any huge discrepancy. Even the bankers will have, because they will be under lot of pressure from RBI, from different third parties, stating that whatever you account it rightly. And next one, in computerized branches, systems generates interest up to a particular date. It has to be ensured whether broken period interest is provided for. A comparative statement of item-wise expenses and income may be prepared and verified for identifying the reason for increase in the profit or compared to the last year, or increase in losses compared to the last year. If it is huge, we need to analyze as to why. Is it because of some frauds? We should have a sort of skepticism in whatever we do. Does the bank have a system of estimating and providing interest accrued on overdue or mature term deposits? They will very well know by this March, I mean by this period, certain types of fixed deposits going to be matured. Are we enough handling the liquidity to meet out the funds, to meet out the requirement of the customer and to finish it off the agreement with him? So it needs to provide for. If it doesn't, you need to report the same. Are there any divergent trends in major items of income and expenditure which are not satisfactorily explained by the branch? If so, the same may be reported upon. I repeat once again, are there any divergent trends in major items of income and expenditure? Not in total, in terms of, say, interest on advances or interest on other than advances. If this shows a wide variation figure compared to the last year, you need to analyze as to why. Is it possibly because of some window dressing to eyewash the chartered accountant who is handling there? Or it is going to show a rosy picture in front of the shareholders? We need to analyze all this upon. A comparative statement for this can be prepared and we can have a check upon. Books and records. Books and records, nothing but actual bank statements, cash statements, different ledgers of expenses, different ledgers of incomes of a branch. So no longer it is being maintained manually, because everything is computerized. So for the computerized, for the same thing reason I earlier mentioned, we need to be familiar with the software we are working with. And in general, whether hard copies of daily reports like exceptional reports, exceptional transactions, cash scroll, general ledger, PL day book, sub day book, debit balances, overdrawn, debit balances overdrawn are printed regularly. I mean, this access and control, I would explain this, because though every account has been computerized, when you pass an entry and when you take in the same day, this will be actually compiled with. And when auditor comes later, they cannot go and reverse that. Although they reverse the transaction, we may able to find the same with the hard copies that has been printed on the earlier day. So this acts as one of the, again, internal control or internal check, whatever we call for. Hope I'm clear. I'll able to once again repeat it. Nothing but every accounts has been computerized. And if they take the important reports, everyday printouts, and they maintain in a huge baskets, and though any entry has subsequently been reversed in the predated, an auditor can come and compare the computerized accounting with the actual physical what they printed on the other day. If any mismatches, auditor can able to know that this transaction has been manipulated. So it can be reported rightly in the LFAR. Are the access and data security measures like passwords and other internal controls adequate? Obtain systems manual from the systems officer at the branch and confirm that the data security measures are in accordance with the guidelines of controlling authority. For example, a banking personnel has to log on only in his systems. He will have a password for it, and we all know this password is highly secure, and this should not be shared even with the co-personnel who is working with. And if at all something happened with the software and it has been collapsed, an admin should come and he should not use the same password of this banking personnel. He'll be having a different password. So therefore, even he is not related with the person who is working. So this is the level of security a banker has to provide with. in this type of EDP environment. And this is a very vital item wherein the entire security data can be misused. Because when a computer can be hacked, entire Indian economy can be reversed. And whether regular backups of accounts are taken on a daily basis and offsite storage are maintained, whether soft copies of all types of accounts are maintained in CDs or pen drives or large hard disk on half yearly basis. So if at all computer crashes, we can take the backup from in which we have been stored.